Well, greetings, church family. Today's daily Bible reading had us in Jeremiah chapters 9 and 10. In the first half of chapter 9, verses 1 through 16, we see lament and interrogation. Jeremiah actually continues his lament that he began at the end of chapter 8. You can really see here how devastated he is that his people in Jerusalem have been so evil that they're bringing devastation and death upon themselves and their descendants in the form of God's judgment. Now, the sins that are singled out most in this first half of chapter 9 are those which involve wicked speech, especially deception. We see that in verses 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8. Verse 4 actually has a very interesting case of this. In the NESB, it's translated as deals craftily, and it comes from the Hebrew phrase, Akov Yaakov. Akov Yaakov. Now, this means will surely seize the heel, or will surely deceive, betray. Sees the heel being a metaphor for betraying or deceiving others. And that's a bit of a play on words because that's the meaning behind Jacob's name, which indeed is Yaakov in Hebrew. So Akov Yaakov is what it says here. Basically, you're acting just like Jacob. He who seizes the heel. Remember, Jacob hung on to Esau's heel when they were born. That's why he was named that way, Genesis 25, 26. And Esau, in Genesis 27, 36, said, "Is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has supplanted me these two times." He seized the heel. He's deceived me, betrayed me. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he's taken away my blessing. Yahweh's declaring that Jacob, Israel, and Judah are acting like their namesake. They're seizing the heel. They're deceiving and betraying their countrymen. And while this lament is then followed up here with a brief interrogation by Jeremiah, who questions which people in Jerusalem and the rest of Judah will be wise enough to understand God's word and heed his warnings. And Yahweh's response is that the people have forsaken his word, thus he's going to bring judgment on them. Then we get to the second half of chapter 9, another lament, but this time followed by admonition. This second lament is prompted by Yahweh, who promises such swift and terrible devastation that his people, he says, are not to prepare themselves for war, but rather for wailing. Babylon will come against Jerusalem. Jerusalem will fall, and in fact, the dead will be visible throughout the land, underscoring just how awful this judgment will be. And this is followed by an admonition in verses 23 and 24 that those who recognize they have wisdom must be wise enough to not trust in their own wisdom. Those who recognize they have strength must be humble enough to not trust in their own strength. In verses 25 and 26, God promises to judge both his people and the pagan nations of the world. In chapter 10, 1 through 16, this first half, we see one true living God. Yahweh turns to warning the people to not trust in idols because such worship of that which is created is a delusion. After all, idols can't talk or walk. They can't do anything. And Jeremiah makes clear in verses 6 through 16 that rather than fear such foolish objects of worship, which are crafted by man, we're to fear Yahweh alone. And some of the most God-glorifying verses in Scripture appear right here. Look with me at verses 6, 7, and 10 through 13. I think it's really important to read these and just glorify the Lord as we do so. "There is none like you, O Yahweh. You are great, and great is your name and might. Who would not fear you, O King of the nations? Indeed, it is your due. For among all the wise men of the nations and in all their kingdoms, there is none like you." And then down beginning at verse 10, "But Yahweh is the true God. He is the living God and the everlasting King. At his wrath the earth quakes and the nations cannot endure his indignation. Thus you'll say to them, the gods that did not make the heavens and the earth, they're going to perish from the earth and from under the heavens. It is he who made the earth by his power, who established the world by his wisdom, and by his understanding he has stretched out the heavens. When he utters his voice, there is a tumult of waters in the heavens, and he causes the clouds to ascend from the end of the earth. He makes lightning for the rain and brings out the wind from his storehouses." Just amazing verses proclaiming how great God is. And then the latter part of chapter 10, verses 17 through 25, we have another lament and a request. After the Lord repeats his promise to cause his people to be captured, taken from their land, Jeremiah gives another heartbreaking lament, and this time his sadness is over both the failed leadership of Judah, verse 21, and God's promise, of course, to bring calamity on Judah, verse 22. Despite knowing that his countrymen are indeed wicked, Jeremiah still requests that the Lord would reserve his judgment for the pagan nations who harassed them, instead of Judah itself feeling the Lord's wrath. Well, when we look at chapter 9, verses 23 and 24, we see, thus says Yahweh. This is, of course, the Lord speaking through Jeremiah. Let not a wise man boast of his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast of his might. Let not a rich man boast of his riches, but let him who boasts boast of this, that he understands and knows me, that I am Yahweh, who exercises loving kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For I delight in these things, declares Yahweh. And that just bring up the question, how can man compare to God? We see that these idols that are made by man cannot. But man himself has turned into an idol in this day and age. You don't have many crafted idols. Instead, you have that which is created by God, as Romans 1 puts it, that has become the object of worship. Man himself, often people worshiping themselves or worshiping one another or even the collective human society, that human secularism that we see, the humanism that is in this world. The answer is man can't compare it to God. 1 Corinthians 1, 26-31 tells us this, "For consider your calling, brethren, that there were not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the things which are strong, and the base things of the world, and the despised God has chosen, the things that are not, so that he may nullify the things that are, so that no man may boast before God. But by his doing you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption, so that just as it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord." Is your boast in your own wisdom and strength or riches, or is your trust in the Lord alone? Do you trust in Christ's life and death and resurrection for salvation? Do you trust in the Word of God as that which we are to live by? As that that brings the Lord such great delight in our lives. The obedience that we then experience joy and comfort and peace through as well. Do you trust in the Lord? Or are we going to trust in ourselves or the things of this world? Some food for thought as we finish out Jeremiah 9 and 10. I hope you have a great day.